All right, good morning. We're going to start a new series this week, and it's on biblical superheroes. Before I get started, though, I just want to say I'm real excited about the 17th coming up. I had shared with the leadership team a few weeks ago that Pastor Nicole and I wanted to become the pastors of this church, and we're really excited about that. So we're excited about the 17th coming up, and we're excited about some changes that we're going to be bringing in, introducing exciting stuff that we think is going to be a very, very good thing. So stay tuned on that. But I love superheroes, okay? I've seen the Marvel movies, okay, some, not all. I like the idea of a fight against good and evil, and I love that the good guy or good girl pretty much always wins. And the good guy or good girl always has supernatural power of some sort that helps them win. Is anybody in here like superheroes? Superheroes? Anybody? Come on. All right. So if you like superheroes, we know Spider-Man's not real. Batman's not real. Even Superman, much to my dismay, is not real. But there are real-life superheroes. There are a bunch found in the pages of the Bible. In this series, we're going to look at some of those superheroes and what their life can teach us for today. Today, we're going to look at Joshua. Now, Joshua, he was a big one. He was a big superhero in the Bible. And if you don't believe me, we're going to walk through some of what he went through today. Joshua 1:1-9 says, after the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant. He said, Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, the time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the Jordan River into the land I'm giving them. I promise you what I promised Moses. Whenever you set foot, you will be on land I have given you, from the Negev wilderness to the south of Lebanon mountains in the north, from the Euphrates River in the east to the Mediterranean Sea in the west, including all of the land of the Hittites. No one will be able to stand against you as long as you live, for I will be with you as I was with Moses. I will not fail or abandon you. Verse 6, be strong and courageous, for you're the one who will lead these people to possess all of the land I swore to their ancestors that I would give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. Then you'll be successful in everything you do. Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night, so you'll be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. This is my command. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Now, I want you to notice something about this verse. Be strong and courageous is found in it three times. Now, in the Bible, if you think about it, back then, parchment paper and things to write on were at a premium. Okay, you didn't write something more than once if it wasn't important. Being strong and courageous is very important. Joshua had a big job to do. He was following in Moses' footsteps. Those were huge shoes to follow in. And God was giving him instructions saying, you're going to lead these people into the promised land, but first you have to do everything I commanded you. You can't deviate left or right. You can't deviate from the word I gave you. And by the way, this is very important. You're going to know this is so important. I'm going to say it three times. Be strong and courageous. I want you to first notice that courage is found in the Lord alone. Now, I'm fearful of a few things, and I'll admit it. Spiders, snakes, wasps, and heights are about on the top of my list. Spiders, snakes, and wasps, I don't know why God bothered, really. I don't like them at all. I know they say spiders eat insects and snakes do the thing with the rodents. Wasp, I have no idea what the good in them is. Heights, I like to keep my feet on the ground. And if we're all honest, we may have something we fear a little bit, but we're called to not be afraid. As I mentioned, I fear heights a little bit, but every now and then, I would find myself on a Ferris wheel. Why would I do that, being afraid of heights? Why would I put myself in that situation? One, it's a rush, and I don't want to be afraid. I know once I'm on that thing, no matter how scared I get, there's no getting off that thing until it's time. It's almost a challenge. I want to do the one at Union Station. Have you guys seen the one at Union Station, the real big one, where the aquarium is? Be a fun one to go to. Maybe we could take a trip there one day. Courage is something that's missing in today's society. It really, really is. We see what's going on in society. People are weak spiritually, physically. Masculinity has been called a bad thing. Americans treat their bodies awful, and talk of courage is often laughed off. We talk about the brave soldiers that serve, and we celebrate freedom this weekend. I heard the beginnings of that last night as fireworks were going off. My dog's looking at me like, what's going on, man? Fortunately, he wasn't too scared. And we're going to hear even more of that tonight because the county police don't like policing our area. So they have a huge fireworks show in Rosewood Heights. We celebrate that freedom this weekend. We celebrate that we are a free country but how did we get there? You know, and all the while, there's people that mock and belittle the brave men and women that have served this country. And boy, That burns my tail. I cannot stand when I hear people say negative things about those people that have kept us free and that have sacrificed their lives to keep us free. It's a wonder. It's not really a wonder that America's in the state it's in. And one big reason for that, and hear me, is a lack of courage. Remember the verse said three times, be strong and courageous. It's important. It's important that we have that courage in Jesus and in God. If we don't, things suffer. Things become weak. Including our country, who was once a superpower, a lack of courage, even in the church, to stand up for what is right. How many churches nowadays, they don't want to scare people off, so we tone down our response on hot-button topics, watering things down. We don't want to upset, so we present this woke Jesus that just loves every evil going on in the world today. How sad is that? Let me tell you, Joshua was given very specific instructions from God on how to do things. He was warned to not turn away from what he was told. We're given the same instruction. That Bible is the same for us. It's the same yesterday, today, and forever. So if he was told to not turn away from what he was told, he's telling us, don't turn away from what you're told. Follow those instructions. They're there for a reason. And the instructions in the Bible aren't meant to hold us down and keep us from having fun. No, they're a guardrail to keep us on the right track. If you remember, the battle against Jericho seemed impossible. But Joshua had courage. He remembered the Lord's words. How often do we need to remember the Lord's words? And we can't remember them if we're not reading them. We'll only be able to stand up to the things in this world by getting close to Jesus. Let me say that a second time so you can hear the importance of it. We will only be able to stand up to the things in this world by getting close to Jesus. We'll only be able to defeat strongholds by the blood of the Lamb. will only be able to see breakthrough in our lives through victory in Jesus. I love that song, Victory in Jesus. I love it because we can have that victory in Jesus. And I'm not talking about prosperity gospel. You're going to get all the money in the world. No, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about true victory and freedom through Jesus. You can have that. That's promised to you. If you find yourself fearing what is going on in the world right now, I have a suggestion. Get close with Jesus. Get your head in the Word. He alone is going to give you strength. 1 John 2:27, but you have received the Holy Spirit and he lives within you. So you don't need anyone to teach you what is true. For the Spirit teaches you everything you need to know. And what he teaches you is true. It's not a lie. So just as he has taught you, remain in fellowship with Christ. The Holy Spirit is going to teach you what is true. If you have the Holy Spirit in your life, if you ask Jesus into your life, if you accept him as your Lord and Savior, if you surrender to him, that Holy Spirit comes into your life and is going to teach you what is true. You don't have to worry about this garbage out there sending you to the right or to the left. You're going to know what is true. The Spirit teaches you everything you need to know, and what he teaches is true. What the world teaches, what some churches teach even, may not be true. But what he, the Holy Spirit, teaches is always true. If you have the Holy Spirit, he alone is going to give you the courage by giving you truth. Courage is found in the Lord only, and you need to remember that. It's not found in guns, knives, body armor, food prep, etc. Although I think we should prepare in the natural for things that are coming, your courage is not found in those things. Courage is found in God and God alone. Next, we notice purity and holiness is important to God. For emphasis, let me say it again. Purity and holiness is important to God. Joshua 3:5. Then Joshua told the people, purify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do great wonders among you. That's right. How you live, how you carry yourself, how you walk through this world is important to God. Focus on that verse for a second. Purify then the Lord. It's an if-then statement. Purify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do great things among you. Now, if they had not purified themselves, what would have happened? We don't know, because they did. It was important that in that order to win that battle, they had to be clean before God. It's the same way with us. We can't expect to win the battles in our lives if we're living a life drenched in sin. It's not. True enough, we all sin. But as a follower of Jesus, we should never, ever be comfortable in a lifestyle of sin. It's sad today that sometimes it's hard to tell believers from non-believers. This shouldn't be the case. We are a set apart people. We should be different. But people won't like me. People hated Jesus. They hated him so much they chose a murderer to be released instead of him. Did you know sin in the church is responsible even for sickness in the church? Listen to 1 Corinthians 11:27 through 30. And we know this verse pretty well because we talk about this verse with the Lord's Supper. So let's start at verse 27. So anyone who eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord unworthily is guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. This is why you should examine yourself before eating the bread and drinking the cup. For if you eat the bread or drink the cup without honoring the body of Christ, you are eating and drinking God's judgment upon yourself. Pay attention to verse 30. That is why many of you are weak and sick, and some have even died. He's talking to the church here, folks. He's not talking to unbelievers. He's talking to believers in the church that are having the Lord's Supper. This is time why I take time before communion to ask God to reveal any sin in our lives that we may not know about. Yes, God forgives sins, but you have to remember the result of sin is death. It says it right here. We believe the Bible is true front to back. It sounds so dated today to talk to kids about purity. I remember when I was in high school, they had this program called True Love Waits. And it talked about purity and not having sexual intercourse until you were married and not doing those things. And you even got a ring signifying that you weren't going to do these things, that you had promised to God not to do these things. Oh, and in youth groups today, that's the least of their worries. My son, he's a youth group leader at his church. And the things they have to address today are way beyond what they had to address when I was in youth group. When I was in youth group, the youth pastor could look at you and say, "You shouldn't be doing that. That is wrong." You look at a kid and say that today, mom and dad call you and curse you out on the phone. I had it happen to me. It's sad where we're at in society today because purity is not a thing. And kids need to know that it is a thing. It's important. Kids are out there celebrating and pride, celebrating sin, parents approving it. It's not okay, guys. It looks like it's okay. We want to put an okay face on. We want to be tolerant. We want to be loving. But being loving sometimes is telling people what the truth is. It's not necessarily following along with them. I use this example. If you had somebody that was blindfolded and you were watching them walking off a cliff, would you stand there and cheer them and say, "Good job, keep going, good"? Or would you say, "Stop, don't do that, you're going to get hurt"? I think we would say the second. We don't want people to be hurt. It's not because we're an unloving people. I love people, but I also know what God's word says. God is not okay with sin, period. And I believe the Bible is true front to back, so I believe what he calls sin is sin. You see, the Battle of Jericho would not have been won had they not followed the Lord's rules, and one rule was purify. And I say to you today, purify yourself. Ask for forgiveness. Turn from those sins that may have you bound. We see in Celebrate Recovery every week people that have sin and have chains binding them. And it makes me so happy when I see those chains loosed through the power of Jesus' name. You're going to be glad you did. Do you want superhero strength in your life? That's the Holy Spirit. Purify. You see, the Holy Spirit cannot operate where there is darkness. He can't. Light and dark can't be in the same place. Sin in the church and steeped in the lives of believers is why the American church and other churches are so powerless. We wonder why the church is powerless. Why are we seeing the things in the book of Acts? And it's a lot of it's sin in the church. I believe revival is coming. I believe that it's already started. I believe Christ is coming soon, and he's coming back for a bride without spot or wrinkle. How does that happen? Ephesians 5, 25 through 27. For husbands, this means to love your wives just as Christ loved the church. Let me stop right there. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church. That means you're willing to die for her. Pay attention to that. Because some people like to talk about how wives need to be submissive to their husbands, and they're jumping past this to love your wives just as Christ loved the church. That was a little rabbit trail. He gave up his life for her to make her holy and clean, washing by the cleansing of God's word. God's word does the cleansing. He did this to present her to himself as a glorious church without spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. Instead, she will be holy and without fault. The church is being purified right now in America and around the world, and it's for his return. You wonder why you see big name pastors, big name leaders, and all these falling. There's a reason for that. God is purifying his church. He's humbling certain leaders and he's humbling people in the church so they will be without spot or wrinkle or any blemish when he returns. His word is true. There will be a remnant without spot or wrinkle. Finally, notice God's instructions for victory don't always make sense. How many of you have ever been given an instruction by God and it does not make sense? I've been given a few of those. Joshua 6, 1 through 6. Now the gates of Jericho were tightly shut because the people were afraid of the Israelites. No one was allowed to go in or out, but the Lord said to Joshua, I have given you Jericho, its king, and all of its strong warriors. You and your fighting men should march around the town once a day for 6 days. Seven priests will walk ahead of the ark, each carrying a ram's horn. On the seventh day, you are to march around the town 7 times with the priests blowing the horns. Verse 5, when you hear the priests give one long blast on the ram's horns, have all the people shout as loud as they can. Then the walls of the town will collapse and the people can charge straight into the town. So Joshua called together the priests and said, take up the Ark of the Lord's Covenant and assign 7 priests to walk in front of it, each carrying a ram's horn. Those instructions seemed a little bit odd, I would say. How is marching around a town going to win a battle? Some of these people had to be thinking, Joshua, what are you thinking here? How are we going to win a battle like this? But they followed the instructions. They followed the instructions. Joshua called together the priests and said, take up the Ark of the Lord's Covenant and assign 7 priests to walk in front of it, each carrying a ram's horn. He was given very, very specific instructions, and they were going to follow these very specific instructions because, remember, they were told to not turn from the left or to the right. They were told to follow the instructions, so they were. They purified themselves. They were going to follow these instructions. Those instructions seemed a bit odd, not exactly the traditional way to win a war. And I'm sure when Joshua gave them, they're probably thinking, this guy's a little off his rocker. But I'm sure there may have even been some bickering in the camp. Because how many of you know when someone's given instructions by the Lord, some people don't see those instructions. They may start a little bickering, but I'm sure you know the rest of the story. Joshua 6, 16. The seventh time around, as the priest sounded the long blast of the horn, Joshua commanded the people, shout, for the Lord has given you the town. And Joshua 6, 27. So the Lord was with Joshua and his reputation spread throughout the land. They got the town. Joshua followed the instructions, and the Lord was with him. And guess what? He even got a little famous in the process. Follow God's instructions, even when they don't make sense. I've had God tell me to do things in my life here on earth that absolutely did not make sense at all, only to have a great blessing come out of it. I'm going to tell you one of those times. We had, at Christmas, I had someone post on Facebook that they needed something. They needed to provide for their kids for Christmas. And, you know, I told Pastor Nicole, I think we should give them this amount. And we had younger kids at the time. And she's like, well, if you think God's telling you to do that, you know, we don't want to stifle what God's telling us to do. So we were obedient and gave that amount. And what was really cool was the lady had sent back a message. She goes, that was such a big help. Thank you. I pray the Lord blesses you 10 times over. Then the next week, I got some back overtime from work almost 10 times exactly to the dollar amount. And that's not just to say, money is not the only thing, and that's not to say, look at Pastor Mike. I'm saying be obedient when God tells you to do something. You have no idea what's in store for you after that. Because you, it would have been enough for this lady to be able to provide some Christmas presents for her kids. But God was faithful and blessed the obedience. He will bless your obedience. But you see, it didn't make any sense to me at the time. I have kids. I have Christmas presents I need to buy. I want to buy my wife a Christmas present. Why? That was a lot of money for us at the time. It didn't make sense. After all, I had just seen a post on Facebook. I wasn't asked to help. This person didn't ask. It was just a post. And, you know, I, as much as I say that's a time I listened to God, there have been many times I have not. Let me just be real with you, transparent with you. There are many times that I've been told to do something by God, and I've been like, God, that makes no sense. I'm not going to do that. And what would have happened if I would have? It's hard to listen to God when things don't make sense. It takes faith. It takes heart to see things through. It, sometimes it takes that superhero strength. You have to call on the Holy Spirit to give you that strength. I found there are literally superheroes all over the place, and they don't wear capes. That would be kind of weird. But there are those out there serving meals to the homeless. There are those out there giving to crisis pregnancy centers. There are those out there fostering kids. They are superheroes. Joshua was just a guy. He put his pants on the same way you and I do every day. He was just a guy. But he was a guy willing to listen to God and follow his instructions even when they didn't make sense. I want to be that person. I want Meadowbrook to be that church. God isn't done with any of us. He's not done with Meadowbrook here. Let's pray. Jesus, I thank you for this message. God, I ask that you give us that superhero strength to follow through on instructions you give us. God, give us clear instructions to reach out, to make a difference in the world, to change lives. God, help us see that even when you don't make sense or we don't think you make sense, that God, everything works together. Everything forms together for your good, for your glory, Jesus. God, work in each one of us this week. Work in our lives. Help us know that when we do something, you're right there backing us up. God, help us be obedient to your word. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right. We do not have service tonight. Enjoy the holiday with your family. We have Bible study on Wednesday, so be sure to come out for that. And we're going to continue this message on superheroes the next couple weeks. I don't know who we're going to talk about next week. I don't know. We'll see what God tells me. So, come back next week. We're really excited about what God's doing here at Meadowbrook. Like I said, we have a lot of new things coming up. We're really excited about. I'm excited to see so many people here this morning and their smiling faces. Let me give a blessing to you and we'll be on our way. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace. And as we go our way today, God, help us to listen to you in all that we do. Amen.